knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call.
I have a Father.
Very good morning to every one of us.
Good morning, good morning, Father.
We thank God for this morning and let us approach the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for our lives. We thank you for your gift of fellowship that we share. Enable us today to see with the eyes of your Son, Jesus, to touch with his hands, and to love as he would have loved on earth. Teach us truly to be like him, that we may be with him also in paradise. For we make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. It's the Tuesday, the 14th week in ordinary time. Our gospel this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 9, verse 32 to 38. I take the reading. A demoniac who could not speak was brought to Jesus. And when the demon was driven out, the mute man spoke. The crowds were amazed and said, "Nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "He drives out demons by the prince of demons." Jesus went around to all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and curing every disease and illness. At the sight of the crowds, his heart was moved with pity for them, because they were troubled and abandoned, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest." Beloved, the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Let us observe just a moment of silence over the proclaimed word of God. Arise, Catholic faithful, rejoice and renew. Our gospel for this morning, as we have said since yesterday, is one of those that not just the people who express faith, but their living catches Jesus' attention. A demoniac who could not speak was brought to Jesus, And when the demon was driven out, the mute man began to speak. Dear friends, this is the situation of Christians today, where many of us are refusing to speak, either because we don't know that we have been healed, because of a past experience, and many excuses that we keep giving. You have a mission, dear friend, to step out of your comfort zone to help somebody who has been mute for a long time to begin to speak. But if a Christian like you and I behave as though we are mute, then when would the world experience the touch of Jesus? Jesus approached the man and drove the demon out of him. Immediately, the man's speech was completely restored. The crowd who witnessed this healing were awed and amazed. They looked at one another and said, "Nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel." Today, it is not too difficult to see that it is right within the church that a lot of people express disbelief, when others on the street will believe that, yay, this is the hand of God. Those of us who pontificate or claim to be in charge will say, no, this is not the hand of God. Let us allow God to work within us. He desires to work within us. There are some of us, if it is not from us, if we are not directly involved, then we would criticize, condemn everything that others would do. The Pharisees were also in the crowd, just like some of us. After seeing Jesus heal the man, they were not awestruck. They were not impressed. They could not have been impressed. They made derogatory and dismissive comments, just like you and I have been doing. What is this? I mean, these are just people playing. Well, it's not true. Why do you do such things? Has it been revealed to you that it is wrong? Or you just feel and are so just envious that people have been touched? They accused Jesus for driving out demons by the power of the prince of demons. Jesus did not allow the Pharisees' criticism and disbelief of him to deter him from his mission. He kept on. He kept on and kept on. Dear friends, be careful when you listen to the Pharisaic conversations around you about things you need to do. We have an assignment to fulfill before it is too late. As Jesus traveled around, he went around the country, around the countryside, everywhere, preaching in their synagogue and proclaiming, "The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent." Then he healed every disease and illness. Jesus had a tender and loving heart. He was sensitive to every person who was in need. Are we like that? Matthew writes, "His heart was moved with pity for them as they were troubled and abandoned. They were like sheep who had no shepherd to care for them." Dear friends, how many of our children are needing people like you and I to tell them the truth, to stay with them, to journey with them, to travel with them? How many couples are not struggling and looking for people like us to be able to accompany them in their journey? Do you know how many are killing themselves by all kinds of decisions? People are in need. The world is in need of people, of those who would give and show testimony. Are you one of them? Can you imagine what Jesus' eyes looked like when his heart was moved with pity? I imagine them to be big, brown, and absorbing all around him. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the eyes of Jesus when he saw the people? And when he looked at them, his eyes. How do your eyes move? Some of us, our eyes always look to jealousy, derogatory statement, negativity. If it is not from your son, if it is not from your daughter, it's not nice. If it is not from somebody you know, Jesus' eyes were moved with pity for everything that he saw. He saw people in need. Jesus couldn't have looked at the people around him. He must have seen the people around him. He didn't just look, but he saw, taking into consideration their histories, their personalities, and their souls. Dear friends, all of us must love all people the same. Don't show love to certain people that you know or are from your tribe, are of your kind, and show less love or no love to those that you don't know. He saw their abandonment. The so-called authoritative Pharisees, who in the very gospel accused Jesus himself of working with Satan. Some of us are into places where we are now slaves. We are Christians, but we are slaves. We are truly slaves. He saw, why is it that we don't learn to go and help? The law is supposed to help people to be free, not to be an enslavement on us. The gospel is supposed to let people feel easy to come to Jesus and not to say that, hey, I'm so much a sinner, I better stay in my corner. That is not the gospel. The gospel is always welcoming people, sinners, to come to Jesus. Clearly, the Pharisees couldn't see the way Jesus saw in that moment. They chose not to see, like some of us choose not to see or act. Jesus is calling us today to choose to see as he sees, instead of merely glancing over people as the Pharisees did. Our God calls us to peer into their hearts, the hearts of people all around us, our friends, our families, our co-workers, and our lovers. Love the people who claim to be your lovers, but love those with whom you work with. Love all manner of persons the same. At least love them. Begin to love them and show respect for them. Jesus asks us to be present and enter into a relationship with all persons, however brief, with the cashier at the grocery store, the announcing customer at work, the annoying customer at work, and that one person whom it would just take too much to completely forgive. That person also needs you. Sometimes, for some people, it is too difficult to forgive. Yet that is your cross, dear friend. That is your cross. Somebody may be annoying you daily, constantly. That is your cross. Take it up and follow the Lord. In truly seeing others, being present to them, and investing time in them, regardless of who they are, I believe Christ wants to show us something absolutely incredible, his own love and commitment to us. When you love as Christ loved, he will bless you as he blesses everybody. No matter how ordinary we may seem to ourselves, our God is madly in love with us exactly as he sees us. And he wants to serve and love us with all of himself, so that you would do the same to a everybody. God loves you the way you are. God loves me the way that I am. That kind of love demands a response. A response to see as he sees and to love as he loves. I would end, therefore, with a question. How would you respond to his love today? How would you respond to his love today? If you are alive, if you can see, if you can hear, all by the grace of God, how much of it are you ready to share with others? God richly bless you. Amen.